do recognise that those people would feel the strongest, will engage more around a consultation process, and we've seen evidence of that within Will in relation to council and the proposals to merge Upton and West Burby Fire Station and seek to build a new station at Torquay Massey, and in fact initially Beesby, and so we recognise that. There's also it's not necessarily a criticism, but there was a challenge to a postal survey that we undertook on behalf of the authority, and whilst it comes at a cost, they also recognise the fact that we've done that only once, and that was given some significant opposition. We wanted to ensure ourselves that we were getting a broad perspective from all of the areas affected, not just necessarily one. We haven't adopted that across the piece because we haven't had the same levels of opposition, and so we have learned that fact from that kind of that observation. What they also say is, in part of this process now, you need to create a learning and lessons learned blog to capture all of the learning that you've been involved in and ensure that you improve and implement that moving forward, which is in process and we will do. We have had the draft consultation framework. Based on the outcome of this internal audit report, we will now introduce a consultation framework which will be implemented before September 2017. Again, the recommendation is that members scrutinise the information contained within the report concerning public consultation arrangements. I'm happy to take any questions.
Yes.
Not really questions, Chair, just a couple of points. I think reading that report, not all consultations are the same, and sometimes you just have to be a little bit ad hoc or proactive and change the way you do things to ensure you have actually done a thorough consultation. I think looking at the costs, I think in all cases we can justify the spend, and I think because that is part of the learning curve, we fully accept that there is a need for the learning log, which is something we can then refer back to as we go forward, and that should sort of help prevent us from overspending in the future by learning from what we've already done. What I would just like to say to members is there is another round of consultation coming up, and I think the best way to scrutinise is by attending. But could I just ask that when we do attend, we remember where there is observers. It's not really for us to say anything. It's just we're observing and scrutinising the process so we can feed it back somewhere else. Thank you.
Just to comment on that, yeah, we have started your consultation, broadest consultation around our integrated management plan for 17-20, so very early stage. There's probably an opportune moment for members to kind of take a look at the consultation that we are undertaking with opinion research services. There was a consultation last night in St Helens, there's one this evening in Sefton, which is a former fire station, and I will have the dates for the other consultation events, yes, which will take place next week, circulated for members' attendance if they so wish.
I mean, where we start from is that we are a public body and we work in a permissive environment. What we've got here, which police, ambulance, many other services don't have, is 18 members plugged in to what, 300-400 elected members across the whole of the county of Merseyside. And in terms of consultation, democracy, that's where we should start from. And we should be bringing to the table our own views, thoughts and representations. Then we go out, whichever process that we go out, and we consult. But at the end of the day, we know we've got the final decision to make. And that decision is made by consulting ourselves with our public, our colleagues, our authorities, and those people that we serve. And that puts us in a very different position to many other authorities across the delivery systems across Merseyside. Okay. So the thing here was to scrutinise and consider, and that report's there. Anything else? Although is that agreed? Yes, thank you. 7. Fire, ambulance, collaborative response to cardiac arrest incidents. This is the interim report on the first trial that we asked for. Pages 149 onwards.
Thanks, Chair. And as detailed, that is the purpose of the report, to take a view at the trial arrangements. Now, this is 2 months' worth of data, so it's not a significantly large amount of data we are utilising, but I thought it was valuable to members to bring it back to give you insight into the work that's taking place. Members approved the report, Chief Fire Officer 12-16, on the 25th of February, to provide the details of emergency medical response trial, which would see Merseyside Fire and Rescue Authority responding to North West Ambulance Service's calls to assist to cardiac arrest call red. Now, what I would just, for absolute clarity, that is all we are responding to as an authority, and that is about managing our resources as much as anything else, and our ability to attend in response to fire calls within the confines of supporting and assisting the ambulance service. So it's cardiac arrest only that we are responding to. As a result of that, we launched the pilot in three locations, those three locations being Southport, Speke and Wallasey, and that being based on the predicted numbers of cardiac arrests experienced in those particular areas, and trying to kind of ensure that we are piloting in the best and most suitable places in the first instance. And we are starting to and working with the unions to extend that beyond those three stations currently. But the current position, just to draw your attention, during the 2 month period, we have had 54 occasions where we have responded to cardiac arrest, and of those 54 cases, we believe we've had 5 positive outcomes, and so clearly not an insignificant percentage really of the calls that we've received. And what we have described as positive outcomes, because certainly there's some sensitivities around data protection and so on and so forth, and what is seen as a positive outcome the longer term may not necessarily end up that way, and what we wouldn't want to do is present inaccurate or incorrect information. So a positive outcome for ourselves is is going to respond to a cardiac arrest where people an individual has collapsed, doesn't have a pulse, or and we have resuscitated them at scene and handed them over to the ambulance service with a pulse, and then hopefully they are in their care, and we will take it from there. We are seeking to fully understand, after 5 cases, which one has seen an absolute positive outcome and seen someone alive today that wouldn't necessarily have been alive had we not responded under those circumstances, and we will play that out with its members, certainly when we're in a position to inform them fully without compromising any of the data protection requirements or the individual's privacy. But, 2 month trial, 54 responses, and 5 occasions where we have provided that positive intervention. We have also, just for members to show absolute understanding, we've also declined 3 occasions, and that we have declined on the basis that we've needed to maintain our 10 key locations for an operational fire response. So it's in support of, it is co-responding, if not responding instead of the fire of Northwest Ambulance Service. So a fire crew attend, might get there 2-3 minutes before the ambulance crew, and then the ambulance crew attend. What doesn't happen is the fire crew get there and the ambulance crew stop attending. They continue to attend, and provide that level of heightened support. The pilot was running till the 30th of June 2016. Clearly, that's coming to a conclusion. However, it's now been extended for further months to get a larger amount of data and intelligence to support it, not just in Merseyside, but through the national secretariat arrangements, where we are looking at it more broadly. So it's across the UK Fire and Rescue Service, with the view to be implementing co-responding nationally on behalf of Fire and Rescue Service in support of our ambulance colleagues. But as I say, not necessarily a massive amount of data at this moment in time, given the period of the trial. But felt it was valuable to members to have a little bit of insight into the questions that have been posed at the performance scrutiny committee previously. There has been a memorandum of understanding drawn up, which puts the parameters in place for operating under these arrangements, and that is a safeguard for both Fire Authority, North West Ambulance Service, and our staff. So those safeguards have been put in and been signed off both by myself and Derek Cartwright, who is now the Chief Executive of the North West Ambulance Trust. Happy to see the questions, Chair.
Yes, President.
Thank you, Chair. I mean, an excellent report, and something that we've obviously been waiting for a long time, and I'm really pleased that our staff are fully engaged with this. Just a request, really. A couple of years ago, members on the authority had the opportunity to have some training on the use of defibrillators. You know, I was one of those, and I'm glad to say I haven't been called on, but I could do with a refresh on that. I'm just wondering, really, perhaps it may be an opportunity now that there may be some new members coming on the authority. Perhaps if we were to refresh that training, it just seems a nonsense that those of us who, you know, represent the public, you know, could be faced with a situation where we weren't able to help one of them, and that would be a travesty. So perhaps we could ask that that be refreshed to all members of the authority.
I think that's very simple. We will, yeah, we will do that. We'll particularly wait for our new members to attend. Yeah. Given the fact that you are, you know, in public buildings across the whole of Merseyside, yeah, on a frequent basis, and the likelihood is those public buildings will have defibrillators. We've got them, and I'm sure the local fire council have got them too. So we will facilitate that training. Absolutely.
Yes. Here's all your papers. Now let's teach you how to deal with heart attacks.
That's the real stuff.
Yeah. 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 It's a very good idea. I mean, you know, this, we turned the corner on this. The Deputy General Secretary of the FPU was here today, and he was instrumental in sort of saying, you know, that we should be doing this. My concern was that we would be swamped by Northwest Ambulance. So it's interesting to hear that we've actually put our core business is fighting fires and rescuing people. Part of that rescuing is if we can help with people having, you know, incidents, infarctions, or whatever. But that's not our top line core business. It is one of the things we try and deliver. So it's very interesting to see how that goes, and a piece of work to watch. So is that agreed? So that's received, scrutinised, and you're happy with that? Next is 8, which is a standing item. It's the forward work plan. And is that this document here? Everyone got that, seen it? Who'll lead us through this?
I can do, Chair, yeah, that would be fine. Just to bring, you've got a nice green version, I've got a bit of the green, so I'll work through it on the basis. You will see from the report itself, a fairly significant number of the reports have been provided to members over that period. Performance against the new FA protocol.
I think the one in the booklet is
the
wrong one.
So again, you know, that's been completed. You know, exploring the relationship between fire and health has been completed. Fire control mobilisation process has been completed. The implementation of the management review and impact of partnership hasn't been deferred, and been deferred in the nicest possible way, because I haven't necessarily been that content with the arrangements that we've got in place at this moment in time and how we are discharging our responsibilities around working with our partners since that managerial review. And I haven't wanted to give something back to members which I'm not necessarily content with. However, we've just made some, you know, managerial changes which I think now will facilitate a better delivery of the partnership where and we'll be focused on district delivery, combined with functional delivery. I think it would be far closer to a far better place. So I'd suggest we carry that over, members, and we bring a report back to Performance and Scrutiny Committee when, probably in the next 2 to 3 months, when we've got a little bit more of an established way of work generated. How effective is our consultation process? Clearly we've had that report today, so that is kind of it's concluded. Progress against our engagement commitments again was delivered and concluded on the 5th of November. How well do we work with partners was subsumed within the previous one, as I said, and we haven't reported that back because I think we just need to do a little bit more work on that at this moment in time. Implementation of new HR policies, that was deferred to this meeting. However, what we've chosen to do, having reflected back on the ask of the authority, was given the significant nature of the introduction of those HR policies, we would bring that report back to the full authority. So they are clear on the card of work being done around those HR policies, that reduction in sickness absence that's been experienced in regards to long term sick, and how we are moving forward. So that will be a report that goes back to the full authority. Functions updates have been completed over the period in regards to the specific aspects of the work, home safety, protection, prevention, etc. And a performance update into the service delivery plan has been an ongoing process, clearly Jackie's provided that end of year update today, and then that is where we are at share, and we will now be in the process as we move forward of potentially developing a forward plan for 2016-17.
It's always the question as to those items which are listed as completed, you take off the list, you take off the schedules. I think the chairman's got a plan to make a slight change in the way Scrutiny operates. That's something for the AGM and the process. But it's important to have scrutiny of what we do. And from that level, Vice Chairman, I thank all of us for being involved in the scrutiny process. The authority's got a big change of membership now, very big change of membership. And so we've got a lot of new people to bring on board and to let them see what it is that we do here, that we're very proud of. Hopefully they can cascade that information back down into their own authorities. Also, we're fighting for our lives, as you know, with the police and crime bill going through Parliament. We don't know what the future will be for the fantastic stuff that we do with our great people here. But my thanks, I'm sure Chairman and Linda will agree too. We've got a great team and I've enjoyed working with everybody. For years and years, it's just been, it's a great place to come, it's a great group of people to work with, and thank you for all the scrutiny that you've done. Okay, so I think actually that was our last item on the agenda. It was. So, if there's anything else, or anybody for anything else, I'll call them.
Just to say thanks to all the staff.
We are very lucky.
The way we produce the easy-to-read documents.
In the HQ, those people who work around paper and our staff in the background, it's all, in the fire stations, it's all around a great team, actually. Great team.
Wish we had it in the committee
council. Chair, can I just, from us, extend our thanks also to the staff of St. Helens Fire Station, because last week there was a report on Northwest News, I don't know whether anybody's seen it. It was a young child who was been suffering with cancer. He hadn't come out the house for a long time. And one of his wishes obviously was to ride the fire appliance, which he did, and the staff, and he used the hose pipe, and he drowned one of our staff with the hose pipe. So to see that and to see the delight on this kid's face, we could tell the kids were suffering because the early eyes with the cancer treatment, and the mother saying what it's done, and just to see that highlighted on the news, that's another part of what our staff go above and beyond the call of duty. Mm-hmm. It's not just about rescue, it's not just about putting out the fires. There's other things they do in the community that the unwashed and young lovely don't see, and I think that needs to be said. We need to take that back to the staff to say, well done on a job, well done last week with that young kid. That kid's going to remember if, however long he's got left.
Okay. Yeah, can I just add, I think another issue that I've picked up in the last 12 months is the industrial relations between the management and the trade unions. I don't think I've ever worked or been in a place where people are working so close together. The challenges that this authority face could create issues with unions and obviously the change, and we just talked about medical response, and how they've adapted with the officers working so closely, and I've heard it through to me, the health and safety. I was vice chair of the team and the health and safety committee, and everything that we took back to management was like an obstacle, it was like a battle, and no one can ever resolve every issue, but they're sitting down and talking to each other and trying to resolve it between themselves, and each one, management might be able not to do something, but their acceptance. But again, management are listening to what the staff are saying on a two-way process. And my 12 months on here has clearly identified that people can work together, and I think this authority is showing the way.
I think that's because of the mutual respect.
Of course.
But that's here now, that wasn't here before.
And that's
because of the change in
way.
Leadership.
Yeah.
Well, thank you very much, Reid. We're done, I think.
Thank you.